Okay, let me get right out of the...
Okay, how about the built-in microphone? I've gone away from the big microphone. I've gone to the class, the computer. Still buzzing. How about now? I'm gonna try to get to I'm gonna get ahead on what we covered before. What's that? It's working now. Okay, I'm gonna basically go ahead and try to pick up where we left off. And part of the homework that people did, I'm still not getting homework from everybody. So I'm just trying to get up to, here we go, worksheet. Let me get back up here. I'm back up. Boy, this is really acting up to me. Even right now it does. How about now? Yeah, I hear it. We're going to try just to use the built-in microphone tonight. So I'm almost to the point. I think I've got the built-in microphone going. All right, we're just going to wait just a few minutes to see if this actually works now. I've done away with the microphone. Okay. Let's see if this works. It's working now? Okay. Let me get out of here for a second. Had posted on Facebook. So this was one of the worksheets. It was symbols and gauges that will be on your dashboard to indicate when there's a problem when you're driving. Now you can't hear now. It's completely silent. Yeah, I think we're good now. It's just I'm getting the comments late. So when I'm getting the comments late, I'm doing other things. So for the most part, I think we're good to go. These are the symbols that I wanted you to write down what they meant, but I want to go over them relatively quick. A was for an airbag. This was basically for being on a truck. You would have to turn it off. B is airbag readiness. C is anti-lock brake system. D is anti-theft system. E, auxiliary power. F, battery charging system. G, brake system warning. H, this is just a warning that something is happening. I, climate control, so this is for heat and air. J is a door lock. K is your oil light, L is your temperature gauge. I would circle that. You need to know that for the midterm. M is your seatbelt. N is fog lamps. O is for four-wheel drive. All right, this is basically when you want to go from two-wheel to four-wheel. P is the fuel gauge low. is fuses. R is hazards. S are your wipers. And then on the second sheet, what you have to do is to figure out what these symbols means. And they may be printed on like the levers. This would be like your hood release. Your horn would be on the dash. T was your day running lights. H is your ignition switch. X is the dimmer switch. Y is your lighter. Z is your dash headlight switch. AA is your overdrive. What that is when you want to be driving at faster speeds, got your best fuel economy, then you're going to go to your overdrive off. B is your parking lights. Double C is your side mirrors, which are on the door handle. Double D is power windows. EE is your rear window defroster. F is your cruise control. GG is your steering wheel. And when I looked at this, I didn't know what this was at first. So if you didn't get this one, then you're going to be okay. H is truck release. Double I is your turn signal. J is your windshield defroster. Double K is your windshield. JJ is your defroster. KK is your washer. Double L is your wipers. And MM is your traction system control. So you need to know these. What I want you to write down in your notes is anything that's red that comes on needs your attention. Anything that is yellow is just a basic warning and it needs your attention at some time in the near future. You don't have to deal with it right off. So red is really important. Yellow, just be aware of it. This is where you would find, and this is an owner's manual for the Toyota that we have for driver's ed. So this is where you are supposed to find most of your answers. So if you had any problems, you would just go to your owner's manual and flip through page by page to find out what these lights mean. Because you're driving a machine that is powerful and worth a lot of money, it makes sense to basically know when it's running right and when it's not. And your warning lights are going to be that source to give you that information to make good decisions of whether you should continue to drive or not. Because you don't want to go down the road and have a future problem and not be able to handle it. So it's much better to handle it in a parking lot than it is while you're out driving. I do want to make a mention to know your vehicle. I asked you to do a diagram of the engine compartment. So this is of the driver's ed vehicle. So I only wanted you to do some of the basic things that are in your engine compartment, like where to put the oil, where's the brake fluid reservoir, the coolant, the radiator, where's the windshield washer fluid tank. So just some basic description and diagram of where things are, I thought would be helpful for you to know. The other thing that I asked you on to know your vehicle was your tire size. And you don't have to write this down, but I want you to know that if you need to get this information, you can get it in any car manual. And if you take a look at the side of your tire, there is going to be a lengthy number. And in this case, we have P215/55R17. And what this number indicates is certain things about your tire. So when you go to replace your tire, you're not going to get just any tire that is 17 inches in diameter. You basically want to know something about the tire construction code. What's the use? Is it for a passenger car? Is it a spare tire? Is it a truck tire? What is the width? What is the rubber? ratio to load index. So basically you get a lot of information for your tire number. And I don't think that most people know this, so I wanted you to kind of make a check in your owner's manual so you have a basic understanding of tire size. So those are the two worksheets that I wanted done. So if you haven't done it, please do it. I know that most of you have done it, but there are still some of you that have not. All right, for tonight's homework, and I'm having a hard time without having my headphones in, so it's kind of odd teaching this way, but at least I think everybody can hear me now. Tonight's topic is on seatbelts, airbags, and helmets. And knowing what you have for safety devices in your vehicle and how they work and why they're beneficial for you, I think will be helpful in changing your attitude towards why should I wear my seatbelt all the time? Why do I need a helmet if I'm on a motorcycle or a scooter? And airbags, where are they located? How much good do they do? So we're going to take a look at these three items when it comes to driving. So the first thing that I want you to think about is that we've come a long way with safety. Back in the 1950s and 60s, we actually thought a device like this was protective to an infant. And no way can a child withstand any type of a crash if they're not secured. So even though there's a metal bar and there seems to be some type of a belt, this child would be severely hurt, if not possibly killed in a car crash. So this was useless, but we thought it was something that was beneficial. So let's go through, they've done studies, and I'm going to give you some statistics, and statistics are supposed to make you aware of the positives and negatives around a particular subject. And with the subject of seatbelts, what we have found over the years with doing different surveys is that young people don't wear seatbelts, even though by law they're supposed to. So ages 18 to 24 are the age group to not wear seatbelts. You've gone through driver's ed, you know what the law is, but for whatever reason, you believe, I'm a good driver, I'm not going to be involved in a crash, I can put my hands out and not hit the dashboard. You've come up with many reasons why not wearing a seatbelt is not for you. But we're going to break down those myths. You're going to basically understand after tonight, hopefully, that it's just not true. And men are less likely to wear seatbelts than women. The other thing we find is that people that are living in the country, so non-metropolitan areas, are less likely to wear seatbelts than people that live in metro areas. Because basically the superhighways and a lot of traffic, and you know that driving with lots of cars around is probably going to be a high-risk situation. So in your mind, a switch flips and you think, okay, now I should be in my seatbelt. But when you're out on a back road or when there aren't many cars around, you revert back to, I'm a good driver, I'm not going to be involved in a car crash, and it's funny how people are leaving comments. So please leave comments that I can actually respond to. The other thing I want you to realize about seatbelt laws are primary offenses and secondary offenses. I think that's coming up in, seat position in the vehicle. People in the back seat are less likely to wear seatbelts than people that are in the front seat. So secondary and primary, let me get to that. I'll go back to this in a moment. So primary and secondary, and I will want you to know this for the midterm. Most traffic violations are what we call primary offenses. When you're speeding, you don't stop at a traffic light, you don't stop at a stop sign, you're going to get a ticket. So that alone constitutes what a primary traffic law is. A secondary traffic law indicates that you did something that was wrong, but they can't give you a ticket for it unless you did a primary traffic law wrong. So the example that they would give is that they can't get you for texting and driving unless you were speeding. So secondary laws are not enforced as much because most police officers wouldn't want to pull you over and give you two tickets. So they may drop off the secondary offense, like not having a seatbelt on, having too many people in a car, not having your headlight on because it's broken, it's off. So they're going to give you a ticket for running a stop sign. Now, in New Hampshire, we have no mandatory seatbelt law for adults. The only primary offense is for young people. So right now, the only law we have for seatbelts is for you under the age of 18. Once you turn 18, you can basically make up your mind and make a decision of whether you're going to use your seatbelt or not. We have found over the years that seatbelts What we have found with seatbelt use is as we get better at manufacturing cars that are safer, that even though people aren't seatbelted, they're living through these crashes. So what we're finding in our statistics, and I'm going to go up to another slide here, is that we can find that people are surviving through crashes. I'm trying to find the main, I guess it was the last slide right here. At the top, number of deaths 2003 to 2012 is 919. And I know, and I don't have the slide up here, is that we're well below 700 now. That we're seeing a dramatic change in traffic deaths because of the way that cars are built. In New Hampshire, we're pretty good. We drive pretty well, but our seatbelt usage is pretty low. It's only at 69% compared to 86%. Nationwide. Males, as we said before, much higher than females. And then we can see the age group that we talked about before at the top. The national average is much, much higher. New Hampshire is thinking about changing its laws with seatbelts. And this was taken out of a newspaper article probably about a little over a year ago, that they're looking at making seatbelt use for adults a secondary offense, which would mean that they would have to pull you over for another reason before they could give you a ticket for not wearing your seatbelt. And if you look at the bottom, it says if the bill does pass, it's going to be $50 for drivers and $25 for adult passengers not wearing seatbelts. So if you've got a car full of people, that number will get quite high when it comes to paying fines. And by the way, the fine goes to the driver. It does not go to the occupant. So if your passengers in the back seat don't have their seatbelt on, it's going to be your ticket and your offense that you have to pay. One of the main myths about seatbelts is that if I get thrown, I'm better off getting thrown from a vehicle than staying within the vehicle. So we're going to take a look at some of the myths around seatbelts. So I'm going to show you a short clip of someone being thrown from a vehicle. Now, you won't be able to see it unless you've got to be paying attention because it's really, really hard to see. So basically what you saw was a car that lost control, went into oncoming traffic, the car got hit, the door was probably jarred open because it wasn't locked, and it got thrown from the vehicle. And we all know that you can't be thrown at that speed because you're going to be hit by other cars. Or even if you just hit the road, there's just no way you're going to survive. Another myth is that you can basically put your arms out and stop yourself from hitting the dashboard at speeds lower than 30 miles per hour. That's totally a myth. Another myth is that you don't wear a seatbelt because if the car gets thrown from the road into water, you're less likely to get out from a submerged car or a car that catches fire, so don't wear your seatbelt just in case you get in those situations. Those are basically all myths. I want you to write down this diagram here. This is going to give you some idea of how the body moves in a crash. So even though you're in your seatbelt, your head moves about 1.9 feet in a 30 mile an hour crash. The chest goes about 1.3 feet in a 30 mile an hour crash, and the pelvis goes about 1.2. Now, depending on your weight, if you weigh a little bit more or weigh a little bit less, it's going to be a little bit more or a little bit less, or the speed is a little bit higher. But what this is supposed to let you know is that unless you have, and I'm going to get out of here for a second. Benefit of the seatbelt. This is a picture of a car that was crashed around 30 miles per hour. I wanted to show you this to let you know that even though you're in your seatbelt, because of the damage that's being pushed by the engine or being hit from the side, that there will be some damage. Oh, you can't hear me anymore? No sound? Can you hear me now? Kath?
No. No sound?
No sound. How about now?
No.
Still no. All right. All right. I'm going to try. Okay, let's see if we can. I'm going to still stay here with me for a little bit. I'm trying to get the mic going again. Okay, is it working now? It's good now. All right, I don't know if it's going to be a problem with showing some of these videos. Okay, when I'm back to the slide, I can hear you. All right. There must be a bug. All right, we'll see what happens with the video. Let me get out of here. All right, how about now? Maybe I won't have to show myself anymore. Maybe it's when I come back to the main screen here, I think. Let's see if this works. All right. I've got a video that I want to show you about why it's important to be in your seatbelt. There are three things that are going to happen. Let's see if I can get this up on the screen before I get out of it. Okay, so up at the top, there are three collisions and a crash. All right? They're going to be in the video. They're going to show you three collisions, three things that are happening inside the car. You need to text me on your phone what those three things are, those three collisions. It's going to be, they're going to tell you, you're going to hit something to something. Let's see, how can I put it without giving you the answer? It's very hard to explain in the video until you see it. So there are three collisions dealing with your body. All right, so let me give you that. With your body, I'll try to work on the sound, and then we'll try to get back to it in just a minute. So this is when physics meets biology.
Why is it that some spectacular race car crashes produce only minor injuries? How can three collisions occur in this one crash between a car and a wall? The answers are determined by the laws of nature and can best be explained when physics meets biology. Through injury biomechanics, the study of the effects of forces on the human body, we've learned much about what happens in high-speed race car crashes, and doctors and engineers have used this information to build safer race cars and tracks. In a similar way, the study of injury biomechanics and crash testing has helped us learn what happens to the human body in passenger car crashes, and what works and doesn't work to reduce injuries and deaths in real-world crashes.
Hi, I'm Griff Jones. I'm a science teacher, and I'm here at the Insurance Institute for Highway Safety's Vehicle Research Center to explore the basic science behind injuries in vehicle crashes. So let's go behind the scenes and take a closer look at what happens to the human body in a crash. What is the first scientific discipline that comes to mind when you think of car crashes? It's probably physics, right? Because Newton's laws of motion govern what happens to a vehicle in a crash. But if we want to understand how crashes cause injuries to people, we need to look at what occurs when physical forces are applied to organs, tissues, and cells. This happens when physics meets biology in a field called injury biomechanics.
The Institute's Vehicle Research Center is a world-class facility for vehicle research and testing. A reporter described the crash hall with its three runways as a cross between a Hollywood soundstage and a NASA cleanroom. Vehicles are propelled down the runways at precise speeds using a system of nitrogen-powered hydraulic motors and cables. The lighting array provides up to 750,000 watts of non-glare illumination for the 500 frames per second high-speed cameras. The research tests they're conducting here today focuses on how injuries occur in real-world crashes. This experimental crash replicates one in which a car hit a tree. In an attempt to understand injury patterns found in the occupants of the actual crash, researchers have disconnected the airbags.
Looking at the driver's chest, we can see the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters of compression. The chest acceleration is 70 to 80 G. Resultant acceleration range. High likelihood of skull fracture.
Very bad.
Yeah, very bad.
Figuring out what just happened in this test crash is the job of the research engineers here. Using sophisticated tools like instrumented crash test dummies, instrumentation in the car, and slow motion film, they can analyze every detail and construct a precise picture of exactly what the vehicle and the occupants went through.
When research engineers use terms like the chest deflection reached about 50 millimeters, how does that relate to what a human occupant would experience? If chest acceleration is 70 to 80 G's, which means that a force equivalent to 70 to 80 times the weight of the dummy's chest is pressing on it, is that survivable? How do these guys know the answers?
The search for the limits of human tolerance to forces began decades ago. Today's race car and passenger car drivers benefit from biomechanics studies that were conducted during the 1940s, 50s, and 60s in the field of aviation, investigating how to protect pilots and astronauts from the strenuous forces of ejections and high-speed travel. Colonel John Stapp, a medical doctor and biophysicist in the United States Air Force, used himself as the test subject in his investigations of human tolerance to high-G environments.
From the outside, watch the breakneck stop.
In one of his many tests, Dr. Stapp reached a speed of 632 miles per hour before one of the most powerful braking systems of all time stopped him in 1.4 seconds, subjecting him to more than 40 times the pull of gravity for 40 Gs. His research helped establish the limits of human tolerance to high G environments and save many lives through development and improvement of protective systems for ejection seats. Realizing the Air Force lost nearly as many men to car crashes as they did to plane crashes, Dr. Stapp began a car crash program using the rocket sled for seatbelt experiments. Human volunteers working with his biophysics research team endured as many as 28 Gs during safety belt tests. This early research laid the foundation for the complex crash analysis that is conducted here today. These dummies are a perfect example of combining science, technology, engineering, and mathematics to produce new tools that extend scientific understanding. They are the modern-day version of Dr. Stapp's volunteers. There's not just one dummy for VRC testing, nor even one type. There's a whole family of dummies for crash testing.
This is our crash test dummy family, ranging from a six-month-old all the way up to a 95th percentile male.
95th percentile of what?
That means that it is larger than 95% of the male population in the U.S.
Wow, so this is a big guy.
Yes, if he could stand, he would be about 6'2", about 223 pounds, pretty big. The female, if she could stand, about 5 foot tall, 107 pounds.
How about the smaller dummies?
They are called crabbies.
Crabbies? Are they moody?
They're not moody, but it stands for child restraint airbag interaction.
And so when we're doing the frontal crash test, it's 50th percentile?
Yes.
Okay. Side impact is the small female.
Side impact dummy is a very complicated dummy. It has the most instrumentation. They have sensors from the head to the toe. The accelerometers give us the acceleration of the mass. The load cell measures force. And then we have the potentiometers that measure the displacement the ribs actually move.
So dummies are very sophisticated. They provide data from many different body regions. But how do we connect this to people? What is the link between all these crash test data and the injuries that people experience in real-world crashes?
The dummy's measuring different things. It's measuring acceleration, force, and in some cases, distortion of the body parts. Those measurements can be compared against similar measurements made in experiments on biological tissues, using either animal models or cadaver models to get an idea of how much stress can this body part take before it breaks. So in order to understand whether or not a person would be injured, you need to know how strong the bones are, how strong the tissues are, and what conditions will cause them to break.
So the crash test dummies try to get a clearer picture of what's really happening to the people. Is that where the term biofidelity comes from?
It's exactly where the term biofidelity comes from. What biofidelity means is the characteristic of the dummy that represents how close to actually being a human being it is. So the higher the biofidelity, the more like a human being it is in representing how it moves, what types of stresses it measures in the crash test, and then the true to likeness of those measurements to the prediction of injury in a real person.
This is how research engineers can tell us with precision what a human occupant would have experienced in a test crash. Dr. Stapp's experiments, plus years of research with real biological tissues from cadavers and animals, have produced a set of reference values against which we can compare the stresses and strains the dummies experience. So, we can measure these in a test crash and can figure out if they would cause injury to a human occupant. But what do these stresses and strains actually do to people to cause injury? Let's start with some basic anatomy. Your body contains over 100 trillion cells and is structurally organized into four levels: cells, tissues, organs, and organ systems. Tissue is a group of similar cells working together to perform a common function. Organs are made up of two or more types of tissue working together to perform a specific function. And each organ is part of at least one organ system that performs major activities or processes. Your body contains four fluid-filled spaces called body cavities that house and protect your major internal organs. Within the body cavities, your organs are suspended in fluid that supports their weight and prevents them from being deformed by normal movements. Your organs are also protected by your bones and muscles. For example, your heart and lungs are protected by your rib cage and sternum inside the thoracic cavity. Your brain is encased within your cranial cavity and is protected by your skull. Now, with this as background, remember the question from the beginning of this film. How is it possible to have three collisions in a single crash? Remember, the laws of physics hold true everywhere, on a highway, on a racetrack, and even inside your body. If a race car is going 200 miles per hour, so is the driver's body and every organ inside it. Let's answer the question. The first collision is between the car and the wall. The second is between the driver and the car's interior. And the third is between the driver's internal organs and the inside walls of his or her body cavities. Tell me a little bit more about the injury. To help us understand more about what happens to organs in the third collision, let's meet Dr. Stephen Olvey, a neurocritical care physician and director of the Neuroscience Intensive Care Unit at the University of Miami's Jackson Memorial Hospital.
Basically, during a crash, you have three collisions. You have the initial crash of the vehicle.
Then you have the occupant hitting something inside the car and coming to a sudden stop.
This results in impacts inside the body. For example, the lungs can hit the inside of the rib cage. The heart can hit the breastbone or inside of the rib cage, resulting in either a pulmonary contusion or myocardial contusion. This is what causes ruptured spleens, lacerated livers, because you have part of the organ well anchored and the other part is free to move about. And this causes a shearing force to take place in the organ, resulting in hemorrhage or tearing of the tissue. The brain is enclosed in a rigid case, the skull, and it's cushioned and surrounded by the cerebral spinal fluid. The cerebral spinal fluid is actually a different density than the brain itself. So in the event of an impact to the skull, the brain begins to move, the cerebral spinal fluid begins to move, but it moves at a different rate than the brain. So it will actually displace the brains in the opposite direction of the initial impact to the brain.
This simple experiment helps illustrate the phenomenon. This represents your skull. There's water inside representing your cerebral spinal fluid, and the red gel is your brain. The gel floats because it's less dense than water, just like your brain is less dense than your cerebral spinal fluid. What do you think will happen to the brain during impact? Will it move forward, backward, or stay in the same spot? Let's see. The initial movement of the brain is toward the back of the skull. The more dense cerebral spinal fluid moves toward the side of the skull impact, displacing the brain in the opposite direction. If the impact is strong enough, the brain will initially impact the back wall of the skull, then rebound and hit the front of the skull.
This type of injury is called a coup contre coup, which is a French term meaning blow against blow. The order of events inside the skull is still debated in the medical community. Whether the more dense fluid displaces the brain in the opposite direction first, or whether the brain moves in the direction of the initial impact first and then is displaced by a wave of spinal fluid is not yet fully understood. By the way, this simple experiment was designed by a high school student for her science fair project. It was later published in a medical journal and has contributed to the debate. Crash injuries occur when stress develops in tissue. Another way this happens is when one part of the tissue or organ is firmly attached to the torso and another part is free to move. For example, with the heart and its blood vessels, the ascending aorta and its arch are mobile, while the descending aorta is fixed. Here's a demonstration of how a sudden stop, like a third collision, can cause an acceleration injury to the aorta. The aortic arch is represented by the unsupported gel. The gel inside the tube represents the descending aorta, which is fixed to the body.
Try to predict what will happen during the collision. The unsupported section of gel continues forward and tears away from the supported gel. During an actual collision, the fixed descending aorta will decelerate along with the body, while the arch and ascending aorta's momentum keep them moving forward. This difference in acceleration or deceleration causes a tear where the fixed and mobile parts meet. Even the inertia of a blood-filled heart can cause stress and strain on the aortic arch.
We've been talking about stress and strain on tissues and organs, and we've seen how a crash applies some of these forces. But what is stress and strain in this context?
Stress is a measure of the average deforming force exerted over a defined area of tissue. Stress produces strain, which is a measure of how much the tissue deforms as a result of the stress.
This special gel has elastic properties similar to certain human tissue, but not all human tissue is of equal strength. Forces and pressures on the outside of your body cause stress within your tissue. Three basic types of stress are tensile stress from stretching, shearing stress from opposing forces, and compressive.
So basically, the three collisions, and most people have texted in their answers, so I think I've got the majority of people that are actually still watching the video here. But most people don't realize about the last collision. And I think that's one thing that we've got a key on when it comes to why is it so important to wear a seatbelt? Why is it important to have a car that has good safety features that will prevent crashes? Why is it good to have a car that has multiple airbags? Is because once we get down to that third collision, we really don't have much control. So let's kind of take it from step to step at the beginning of the crash. The initial crash, where the car hits an object or the wall, has a lot to do with you as a driver. Many people go years without having a collision. I hope that you drive many, many years without having any type of a collision. So to be trained as a good, safe driver is really important, or else you're going to have to suffer through a lot of trauma. The second collision that they talked about, where the body hits the inside of the vehicle, you have some control over that. You have control over the type of vehicle that you drive. You can buy a car that has a lot of safety features. That is, sits a little higher than a smaller car or a sedan. You can put your seatbelt on. You can basically, when it comes to passengers being protected, you can make sure that your passengers have their seatbelt on. But when it comes down to the very last collision, you really don't have much control. It's just the way that your body is made, how you are hit. Not that you don't, I guess you could say somewhat, there's a bit of luck involved in some crashes. But once the body starts to bend and to twist, as you can see in the last part of this video, it is doing a lot of internal damage. And I can't stress enough that even though you think that you survived a crash and people are helping you out of a vehicle after a crash, there still could be some internal bleeding, some internal damage. So I can't stress enough to make sure that you get to a hospital after a crash. Because what looks like a minor, you know, thing on the outside, you know, a little bit of blood or a little bit sore, could be doing a lot of damage inside your body. So please, please, make sure that you call for an ambulance as soon as you can after a crash to have you checked out, your passengers checked out, other people that are involved in the crash checked out. But I thought that was really important because most people just think of car hitting another car. We really don't think about what happens inside the car or inside our body. So we've got to look at the bigger picture when it comes to crashes. Now we're going to take a look at airbags. Airbags have been around since 1970. But it really didn't happen where it was a
mandatory device in a car until probably the late 80s, early 90s. I think it started off as being a pretty expensive add-on. You could probably have it installed in your vehicle back in the late 70s, early 80s. But then when we found out how beneficial that they were and when we could mass produce them, then airbags got to be standard features. And the standard features that we're seeing now in cars are like blind spot monitors, automatic braking if you're getting too close to a vehicle, automatic cruise control, self-automated vehicles. So with technology, we're seeing great advances with safety. But if you take a look at the inside of a car, and I think it's important to have a basic understanding of where all these things are, that airbags basically only protect you with a front or side crash. It really, you're not going to get any benefit from an airbag from a rear collision. There are sensors on the front of the vehicle and now onto the side of the vehicle that knows when the car is starting to be impacted, where there's a need for the airbag. What I want you to write down in your notes and for you to know for your midterm is airbags begin to deploy when they can sense a crash of at least 15 miles per hour. So when airbags come out, it's not going to be for that inadvertently backing into another vehicle, bumping the curb, bumping a telephone pole, in a driveway or a mailbox. The speed would be way too low to constitute the airbag to be deployed. So those sensors, and I used to have a funny video of a woman with a handbag just swinging around with her handbag and hitting the sensor just right, and the airbag came out. I'll see if I can find that, but I don't have it loaded in for tonight. But in your notes, I want you to do a quick diagram of, make a square where the front of the car is, and just put right near the headlights, just below the headlights, are where you're going to find your sensors. And the sensors will trigger an impulse up to the operating system for the airbag in the steering wheel, just above the glove compartment, and your A-pillars, which is right near your side windows, and down near your legs. It will be activated once the sensor knows that the crash is substantial. The airbag comes out in like 4/100ths of a second. I mean, it comes out extremely fast. If your airbag wasn't installed correctly or built correctly, and force of an airbag can break your nose, it could do some facial injury to you. So airbags have gone through, you know, a lot of testing, a lot of refinement to make sure that they're providing you with the best possible, what we call a ride down, when your body kind of gets softened by the pillow of the airbag. Because if it stayed solid, you know, that's when you're going to start having some serious injuries. Now, the adjustable head shoulder belt, just be familiar that if it sits too high in your neck, you can always adjust it down. And I'm not going to snap out and get into my picture because I'm afraid I'm going to lose sound if I go to something else. So let me get into a quick clip on airbags.
Not only does it ruin your day, but it can leave you with serious injuries or much worse. A proliferation of people refusing to wear seatbelts in the United States back in the 70s led to car makers designing better safety systems to stop natural selection from wiping out a population. And they were called airbags.
Today, airbags are one of the most common safety features you'll find in a new car. But how exactly do they work?
In simple terms, airbags are tightly packed nylon bags designed to inflate within milliseconds of an impact occurring, stopping your head and body from hitting points around the vehicle like the steering wheel, windows, or other hard points, which can cause serious damage.
Sensors around the vehicle are able to detect an impact force, like another vehicle hitting yours, sending an electronic message to deploy whichever airbags are needed to protect occupants. The car is able to work out whether the impact is significant enough, as the force of the airbag deploying may do more harm than good in a low-speed accident. While early airbags were designed purely to protect the driver, most new cars have an array of airbags spread around the cabin to protect every occupant.
The Santa Fe we have here has 6 airbags, one in the steering wheel, one in the passenger side dash, one in either of the front seats, and curtain airbags that cover all 3 rows.
Again, because airbags deploy with significant force, you can do yourself serious damage if your arms get in the way or if you're simply sitting too close.
Once upon a time, the correct way to hold the steering wheel was at a 10 and 2 position. But driving instructors now say the best position is a 9 and 3, so the airbags have enough room to deploy without causing serious damage by having your arms in the way.
But there's more to occupant safety than just airbags. Cyclist and pedestrian detection systems are another important safety feature that you'll hear more about in the future. In the Santa Fe, it's called Side Exit Assist. If an occupant attempts to open the door while vehicles, cyclists, or in our case, someone on a skateboard is close by, the system will sound an alarm and in some cases prevent the door from being unlocked. The system also reminds the driver to check surroundings are safe before unlocking passenger doors. If you do open the door while a hazard is detected, you'll get this warning. Finally, we have child presence detection systems. So far, Hyundai is the first car maker to introduce the tech, reminding drivers to check the rear seats before exiting the vehicle. It's called Rear Occupant Alert. The system uses sensors in the ceiling to detect movement after the vehicle has been locked. It stays active for 24 hours and will sound the car's alarm if it thinks you've left someone behind. If you've installed Hyundai's AutoLink app on your smartphone, you'll also receive a text if you haven't tended to the car alarm. Just as airbags can save you in the case of an accident, car makers are constantly developing tech like Side Exit Assist and Rear Occupant Alert to prevent accidents happening in the first place.
So airbags, let me get to the next slide here. There are two types of safety restraints. So airbags are passive restraints. So write down the two types of restraints we have in a vehicle are passive and active. Definitely passive is probably the best because there is nothing that you have to do except buy a vehicle that has airbags or has automated seatbelts or bolsters that will come across your body once you get into the car. That's more or less on more race cars. Higher end vehicles will have those type of belts. For the most part, seatbelts are active, which means we manually have to be involved in clicking the seatbelt in order for it to work. But as I said earlier, you've got to make sure that you have it adjusted correctly. You've got to make sure that the harness is laying on your hip and across your collarbone at the right angle, because it could do some damage, and pretty bad damage actually with the shoulder harness if it's not where it needs to be. We'll talk about child restraints in a moment, but I wanted to stress that the more things that you do before you put your vehicle on the road, when we talked about making your checks, one of the things that we do is making sure that our seatbelt is on and making sure everybody else in the car has their seatbelt on, because we are responsible for our passengers. A few negative things about airbags. They're not going to be very effective if we're not in our seatbelt. If you're going to leave the roadway and the car is losing contact with the road where it's skidding out of control, you're not going to be right behind the steering wheel. Your body's going to move against the window or across the other side of the car. So when you finally do hit something at above 15 miles per hour, when the airbag does come out, you're not there to benefit from it. A lot of people believe it doesn't matter what age you are, you're in the front seat, you're going to be protected by the airbag. Not really. People under 12 really don't get the full benefit of an airbag, so don't put them in the front seat. Put them in the back. If they have to be in the front, like with a truck, we saw with the controls, one of the symbols that we had was a turn-off knob for the airbag for the passenger in the front. You got to turn that off. If you're very short, airbags is going to maybe not be a benefit to you if you don't have your seat adjusted correctly. And basically what we're talking about is distance to where your body is. A lot of people that are like under 5 feet or 5'2" and below, they get the steering wheel too close to their chest. So you got to make sure, I like to say, here it says 10 inches. I like to have that you have at least like a piece of paper. You could fit a piece of paper between your body and the steering wheel. And then airbags will also protect you according to where they are on the side. We have them on the door frames. We have them down near our legs, especially in trucks and SUVs that have a tendency to go off-road. Let's talk about what you do with your feet when you're a passenger. How many of you have, and you can put this in the comments for whether you've done this or not. How many of you as a passenger has put your feet on the dash like the girl that's riding with this guy? I think at least half of you, if you are honest, would have to admit to this. But you need to understand that airbags come out at around 100 to 220 miles per hour. So that is the force that your feet are going to be coming back towards you. And this is what you would look like. This is a girl that had her feet on the dash and her knee came up and hit her in the head and did that type of deformity. And this is after multiple surgeries. So her head was actually more severely deformed than this at one point. Let's see, I think we're getting people texting in here. Now, some people said that they haven't. I bet you there are some that have. I'm not going to go through the seatbelt position because I think we already know that. Head restraint, we're going to talk at the... We talked about the miss already, about catching on fire or being thrown from a vehicle, so I'm not going to go through the miss. Oh, see, some people have. Some people put it on. I've actually seen someone drive with their leg out the window. So the driver's got their leg near the side mirror. Can you imagine what would happen if the airbag came out then? I think they would lose their leg. So let's talk about when you have kids in the car. Children should be at least 40 inches tall. Now, this is from the manual. This is stuff that you need to know. Some of this stuff will be on a state test or on the final or midterm. Children should be at least 40 inches tall to wear a shoulder harness. So if they don't have a shoulder harness that's going to be beneficial for them, they should be in a booster seat. And a child less than 6 and less than 55 inches in height should be in there we go, there's the booster seat. Under 18, we know that you have to be in a seatbelt. Let's take a look at what we can do with, and I think being summertime, a lot of you probably babysit once you get your license, and maybe hopefully by the end of summer, maybe the people you babysit, whether it be a relative or a neighbor, they trust you enough to take the kids to the park or to go get an ice cream, that hopefully you will understand how to put kids into their seat, booster seat, child restraint seat, or where to locate them in a car to be extremely safe. So let's take a look at child safety equipment.
More than 1,000 children 12 and under die in car crashes every year. And more than 100,000 are injured. But parents can reduce the risk to their kids if they put them in an appropriate car safety seat that's correctly installed in their vehicle. When a vehicle is moving at 30 miles per hour, so is everything inside it. If the vehicle crashes, unrestrained objects keep moving at their original speed until they strike the vehicle interior. This is why infant and child car seats are so important. They hold child passengers in place as the vehicle's front end does its job of crumpling and absorbing energy. This test demonstrates something parents don't even want to think about, an unprotected infant smashing into the instrument panel. Some parents think it's okay to ride with a child on their lap, but it's not. Crashes happen so fast and are so violent that you can't protect a child this way. Frontal airbags can be especially dangerous. In a crash, an airbag can hit a child or car seat with tremendous force. Even older children shouldn't sit in the front seat. The temptation to play with the radio can put them in harm's way. Children are always safer in the back seat. The basic types of car seats are rear-facing infant seats, forward-facing child seats, convertible seats that can be used either rear or forward-facing, and booster seats for children who've outgrown their forward-facing seat but aren't big enough for adult seat belts. Consider your child's age and size when picking out a car seat, and whether it's compatible with your vehicle's seat and seat belts. Not all car seats will fit well into your vehicle. Proper installation has always been a struggle, but it is getting easier. Since September 2002, passenger vehicles are required to have special anchors, and most car seats have to be made with attachments that fit into them. This system is called latch. Lower attachments mate with anchors in the seat. Anchor points are usually marked. For forward-facing seats, top tethers get attached to anchors on the rear shelf or on vehicle seat backs. Car seats and vehicles without latch are still safe if you use the vehicle's belt system correctly. In order to do this in some vehicles, you may need to use a locking clip. Keep in mind, a car seat that fits easily into one vehicle may not fit very well, if at all, into another. Before you buy a car seat, try it in your vehicle to be sure it's compatible and can be tightly secured. Also, be sure to read the seat and vehicle owner's manuals to make installation go more smoothly. In some communities, you can check the installation at county checking stations, police or fire stations, car dealerships, or hospitals. If you're in a severe crash, inspect your child's car seat. If there's visible damage, you'll need to replace it. Remember, your child's safety is up to you. Always be sure he or she is properly buckled in without fail, every ride.
I'm not going to click over to where you can see me, so hopefully you can hear me coming out of the video. There's a couple things that I want to mention that they talked about, which is really important, is that make sure that a young infant, probably less than a year and a half, has the rear facing seat. Don't ever put a young child that does not have good head and neck muscle control facing forward, because every time that you brake and you feel the pitch of the vehicle, your head goes forward if you're facing forward. It does the opposite when your head is facing the windshield. So when you pitch, the head goes against the back of the child restraint, and then there's just a softer comeback when you come to a resting stop. And make sure that most children are buckled in the middle. The middle car seat or seatbelt area is the best place in the car. That is where it does not matter whether you're being hit from the front, from the rear, from the left, from the right. It takes more for the impact of a vehicle to reach to that middle portion of a vehicle. As a child gets older, then you can put them facing forward towards the windshield, and you can probably put them at different parts of the back seat. Now, of course, not everybody can go to the middle seat belt. So I would go with the youngest in the middle, and then I would go the second youngest would be over behind the passenger side on the right, and then the oldest would probably be over behind the driver. Because cars are more likely, I think percentage-wise, more cars get hit from the left than they do from the right on the side. So just remember, when a car gets hit from the side, that impact is coming right up against your shoulder, your arm. This is why there's a lot of injuries to the left side of your body. So putting kids in a safe spot is really important. Okay, let's talk about, do you always have to be in a seatbelt? No. If you're in a limousine, if you're in a school bus, of course motorcycles don't have harnesses or lap belts. Antiques never had them, so you don't have to retrofit a vehicle. And then if you're on some type of medical plan where you're in a wheelchair or whatever, you have some type of designation, then you don't have to wear a seatbelt. Now, I would recommend finding ways to be secure in some of these vehicles and be on your best driving behavior because you don't want to get injured. The last safety piece of device that we're going to talk about are helmets. Now, this is driver's ed. You are driving a vehicle, but once you get your operator's license, as we said earlier, you can make an application and get your motorcycle or scooter's license. And it's important to make sure that you are protected. There are no built-in airbags for motorcycles per se. There are some aftermarket things you could put on. I actually had a video where they sell leather jackets that have a backpack on the back of the coat or the leather jacket, and it will deploy some type of an airbag protection so your head doesn't hit the pavement when you leave your motorcycle. So there are ways that you can get somewhat safer on a motorcycle, but for the most part, you get thrown from your bike or you put your bike down, there's going to be some road rash, there's going to be some injuries, and the most important thing is that you protect your head. And I have a short video clip from a person that was involved in a motorcycle crash, and he truly believes he's only alive today because he has because he had a helmet on. So we'll take a look at that in a moment. The last thing mentioned here is that eye protection is a must. Anybody that's on any type of motorized vehicle has to have eye protection. So whether you're the rider, the driver of a motorcycle, eye protection, you have to have. So let's take a look. Oh, this was an article I found that I thought was kind of humorous. I shouldn't say humorous because a person lost their life, but ironic, I guess, is what I want to say. Here's a person that was being involved in a road rally protesting, why do we have to wear helmets in New York? They did not want a helmet law in New York. So a bunch of bike riders got together on a Saturday, decided they were going to protest helmet use. Well, one of the riders lost control of his bike, went over the handlebars, hit his head on the pavement, and he passed away. So as you can see, an article like this does not do your cause any good because it proves the point the other way. It says why you should have a helmet. And let's take a look at what helmets will actually do.
How helmets work to protect your brain. For every mile traveled in the U.S., motorcyclists are 37 times more likely than drivers to be in a fatal crash. Motorcyclists without helmets are over 3 times more likely to suffer a brain injury. And each year, just in the U.S., about 800 more motorcyclists could have been saved from death by wearing a helmet. Let's first look at how brain injury happens during a motorcycle crash. The skull is like a bus. The different parts of the brain are like passengers right next to each other. Imagine that a school bus hits a wall, smashing right into it, a total mess. The bus is crushed and the passengers thrown about, everything flying. It's much the same in a direct head impact. A person's head smashes into something and suddenly there's a mess. Blood everywhere, and inside the skull, torn tissue and broken blood vessels. The damage is obvious. But suppose the bus driver somehow managed a panic stop. The bus looks okay, no damage to the outside, but inside, there'd still be a mess. kids and their stuff everywhere. Lots of cuts and bruises. The force from that panic stop would reach inside the bus and rattle the contents while leaving the bus unmarked. The same has been seen in helmeted head impacts. If a severe impact overwhelms the helmet, the face and skull might look okay. There might be no blood or fractures apparent, but inside, just as with the school bus, there's chaos. There can be stretched and torn neurons, broken blood vessels, and a host of injuries. Bleeding leads to more pressure inside the skull, damaging brain cells. Brain cells do not like to be touched by blood cells directly. These injuries can result in serious health and behavioral problems, and even death. But say the driver is really good. She sees the wall and applies the brakes firmly but carefully. The bus slows to a controlled stop just short of the wall. But now the kids remain seated and hang on to their books and backpacks. When they get to school, the children can tell their friends and teachers about their close call. It works the same for people wearing good helmets. When the helmet strikes, it stops moving almost immediately. But the helmet's thick inner liner allows the person's head to remain in motion for a while longer. The liner, as it is crushed, applies a controlled braking force to the head to slow it to a gentle stop. So long as the head is stopped before the helmet runs out of liner, the impact is softened to a tolerable limit. A truly protective helmet is constructed with a foam liner to cushion the head and a hard shell to prevent penetration. The hard shell spreads the impact force over a larger area of the liner, just like a thumbtack spreads the pushing force over the thumb. Having a good helmet on your head is like being on the right side of the thumbtack.
Ow!
The Snell helmet standard for motorcycling is the most stringent in the world. Snell M2015 certified helmets protect the brain in both low and high energy impacts and assures you the same head protection enjoyed by most competitive racers. Snell M2015 demands all the protective performance currently available to riders.
So you can see that the cartoon basically was a lot like the video that I showed on physics meets biology about how the body is being slowed down in a crash with a seatbelt. And we call that ride down. Ride down. So the airbag is cushioning the impact. It's softening any type of hitting of the dash or the steering column. And anything we can do to slow down our organs, our brain, will help us survive crashes a lot better. So you can see helmets are really the only thing that we can do, the main thing we can do to protect riders. And as I said, here's the real story of someone that survived a crash. He's only alive today because of the helmet. He was injured, and as you will see soon, he is a paraplegic. But his outlook on life is so positive. I really do like this video because it does bring home why it's important to wear a helmet. But also, if you ever do get injured in a vehicle and you become disabled, your life does not stop. You still have a life ahead of you. So have a positive attitude. And I really do like his story. So let me just show you his story.
Hey YouTube, it's Brian. Today's video I feel is very long overdue. Kind of wanted to talk about my motorcycle accident and more importantly the helmet that I was wearing in the accident. In 2009 I was pulling out of my work parking lot. I was pulling onto a fairly busy road and there was a bunch of parallel parked cars on the side of the road. So when I pulled out I turned right and I didn't see an oncoming car that was actually speeding. And right after I pulled out, the road started to curve. So what happened was I pulled out, saw this car coming, floored the bike trying to get out of the way, and got a little too close to the curve, the actual curb of the road. And there were a bunch of trees on the side of the road, and I happened to tip the bike over against the curb and slammed headfirst into a tree. I was doing about 35 miles an hour. Not anything crazy fast, but this is what happened to my helmet after the accident. As you can see, I caved in the entire top of the helmet. As a result, this broke my spinal cord, and from the chest level down, I'm now paralyzed. So I know you're probably thinking, you know, why would I want to listen to a guy who's paralyzed talk about helmet safety? Well, there's quite a few reasons. First being that I have zero brain injury. That was the biggest thing. My injury is completely physical, which has allowed me to do a lot of things. Obviously, I can still work. I co-manage a group of over 30 people. I can actually still take care of myself. I can take care of my bathroom routine. I can get myself dressed. I am fully independent. I'm married. I have a beautiful wife. I have a great job. I have, you know, a sports car. I like to autocross my car, which is a form of racing, and I do that quite a bit. I still work on cars. That's something I've always really loved to do. So there's a lot of things in my life that I don't think I would have been able to do had I had a brain injury. As you can see, I wouldn't have even had that chance had I slammed headfirst into a tree. I would have been completely dead. There was no way that I would be sitting here talking to you today. I actually went through rehab with a guy who had a similar accident. He was going through an intersection on his bike. A car was coming through, ran a red light. He slammed into that car, flipped off his bike, and he didn't have a helmet on, and he hit his head real hard on the concrete. He was not the same guy that he was before. He it basically knocked him back to third grade. When he was in rehab, he was tripping over himself. He was rambling. You know, he would just start talking, you know, gibberish. He just wasn't present. He wasn't himself. And that is one thing, the biggest thing, aside from my life, that this helmet has saved is my brain and my personality. When it comes to brain injuries, it can vary as far as what your symptoms are. It's all about where your brain was injured. So there's people who have lost complete memory. They actually have to write things down throughout the day to keep track of what they've done. If they went to the bathroom, you know, if they just anything throughout the day, they're actually writing it down. Their speech can be impaired. All these things are preventable from wearing a helmet. There's a lot of people who were married and they ended up getting divorced as a result of their brain injury because, you know, they might be very hard to take care of. Or the other thing is, since their personality is so much different, there's women that have said, you know, this isn't the same man that I married. That is one thing that I feel like I still have. I still have my personality. I'm still the same person. I can still joke. I can still do everything, you know, mentally that I could do before my accident. Obviously, there are some restrictions from a wheelchair, but I've overcome quite a bit of stuff. I even, believe it or not, I even modified my motorcycle to ride post-injury. It had little legs that folded down and a electric shifter. So what I would do is I'd push a button, the legs would fold up out of the way, and I would ride again. So that was one thing right after my injury that really kind of kept my mind out of the dark side. Obviously, I had a couple times where I thought about committing suicide. I didn't think that I could live my life from a wheelchair, or at least not have a quality, you know, life. I've found that that's complete bullshit. I have a great life. You know, like I said, I've got a great wife. I still hang out with friends. I still go on vacation. I still go swimming. I still do pretty much everything that I used to do. I just do it a little bit differently. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. I know people that ride motorcycles are extremely hard-headed. I was one of them. My accident, I thought, you know, if I ever got in an accident that I would break a leg or I would break my arm. I never imagined that I would smash into a tree and be paralyzed. But then again, if I hadn't been wearing the helmet, I would be dead. That would have been end of story for me. And I don't have the brain injury, like I said. So I can still do everything that I did before, just a little bit differently. Another thing I've still been able to do is watch my niece and nephew grow up. just to see them from a little baby and, you know, the toddlers they are right now, to watch a child grow is just an amazing thing. I think, you know, if I was already a father, there's no way in hell I'd be on a motorcycle myself. But think about that. I mean, if you got killed, who's going to take care of your kids? And do you really want them growing up without a father, or growing up with a father with a brain injury who can't take care of them? I think that is the biggest reason. If you are going to choose to get on a bike, you need to get a helmet and you need to wear it. Don't have it strapped to the side of the bike as you're going down the highway. That's not going to help, because anything can happen. That's one thing I've figured out. I took a advanced riding course 2 weeks before my injury. I mean, I was a safe rider. I did everything I thought I should. I wore the full gear, and stuff happens. I mean, it's just how it works, especially these days with everybody on their cell phones constantly. Accidents are everywhere around the corner, and if you're on a motorcycle, you don't have a cage around you. You're not in a car. You don't have an airbag. You're pretty much exposed to anything and everything on the road. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. If you have any questions, write in the comments below, and I'll talk to you soon. Thanks a lot.
Okay, hopefully you got something from this video. I really did. It's unbelievable what he looked like after the crash and what he's able to still accomplish. Now, I don't know if I still would be riding a motorcycle like he is. I think that's probably a little bit much, but, you know, it gives him that thrill that will keep him alive and keeps him vibrant. And I really liked what he had to say. Now, we covered three things tonight. I know tonight was kind of a mess with the sound and the videos and everything else. I'll try to reboot and to get some type of a patch or an update on this thing that I'm using. But I really apologize for the way things went tonight. I still have a few more drive times. 5 o'clock is taken on Thursday, but I've got 8 o'clock tomorrow, 8 and 1 on Thursday still open. And I want to go over the homework because a lot of people aren't quite sure about what the project is. The project is to take a look at what we covered tonight with seatbelts, airbags, and helmets. Any statistic that we talked about or any technique or, you know, why you should be in your seatbelt and how to adjust it, things like that. Anything from the manual. You can even go online to get some information about seatbelts, but I'm going to give you three choices for the project. You could do a poster, you can do a radio ad, or you can do a video. So a poster would be something like this, okay? Give me two facts. So in 2016, seatbelts saved almost 15,000 lives. Three quarters of people ejected from their cars die from injuries. Wear your seatbelts. So I want it to be visual. Use graphics. You can be an artist. You could draw it. Here I think they did clip art, so that's fine. You can do that. So it has to be colorful, has to have two facts, and it has to persuade someone to wear a seatbelt, wear a helmet, or make sure they buy a car that has good airbags. Now, you can do a radio ad. A radio ad would be around 30 seconds long. So here's a radio ad.
And you think seatbelts just aren't cool. What is cool to you? Surviving a car crash or being thrown out your windshield and onto the street?
So this was done by a student.
If you wear your seatbelt, you double your chances of survival. If you are injured in a car crash, wearing that uncool seatbelt will also reduce the likelihood that you have a serious injury by about half. Young listeners, focus on trying to live. And everyone else, influence the smart behavior of wearing seatbelts. Always wear your seatbelt and make the behavior common, expected, and cool.
So I thought he did a fantastic job on a radio ad. So he's got a great voice for it. He gave a lot of specifics about wearing seatbelts. He tried to persuade you. The last thing is you can do a video. Let me show a video. Now, a video will not be due tomorrow. Radio ads due tomorrow. Seatbelt posters due tomorrow. The video ad can be all weekend. You've got all weekend till next Tuesday to do a video. So here's a video.
All right, Violet, time for school.
Can we listen to some music?
Yeah, what song?
You know what.
And only Digo Double G.
Snoop Dogg.
Da, 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 da. You know I'm mobbing with the D-R-E.
Yeah. You know the West Coast is back for all you suckers.
What? Suckers.
So put something in it. Put it in it. Yeah. Suck Snoop.
Top dog by them all. Yeah, I'm burning it up. DPGC, you should be talking.
So I thought he did a fantastic job. It had humor. I didn't have the statistics that I had hoped at the beginning or the end, but he did such a great job. I was really, really pleased with that. So have some fun with it. You can use friends, family members, pets. People use match boxes before. It'd be something that we can actually share in class maybe next week in at the beginning of a few classes before we get going. So. Like I said, I apologize for being so disjointed and why we had so many technical problems tonight, but hopefully it drove home the importance of wearing a seatbelt, wearing a helmet, and having a car with good airbags. So that's it for tonight. That's the only thing that you've got for homework. Tomorrow we're going to do vision, communication, and turning. So if you want to do some reading, do chapter 6 and 7 in responsible driving and read section 5 and 8 in the state manual, and that will get you up to speed. So if you want to do some reading before class, because we're going to be covering it all tomorrow night, that is what we're going to have for a topic. So that is it. If you've got any questions, feel free to text me. I already gave away 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. So I still have 5. If anybody wants to drive at 5 o'clock tomorrow, just send me a text tonight. If not, send me a text with what you're available for Saturday or Monday or Tuesday next week and plan out your week so you at least get one drive in, if not two. And Sam, I put it on the comment section. I need you to text me your number. I do not have it. We're not communicating by phone, so it's going to be hard to schedule you with any driving. So please do that if you are still on. All right, so that is it for this evening. We will see you tomorrow night at 7:30. Cross your fingers. No problems tomorrow night. All right. Have a good night.